Hey, welcome to The Bridge Online. My name is Jeremy, and I am so glad that you are joining us today. If this is your first time with us and you're tuning in on Sunday morning, be sure to click the new here button so that we can connect with you and send you a free gift as a way to say thank you for taking the time to connect with us. Now for the regulars in the house, welcome back. We're so thankful that you continue to connect with us online each and every Sunday. Now we are in week 3 of our series Roots, where we're on a journey together to discover what it takes to root our faith in a way that produces fruit and withstands the challenges that we face in life. Today, we're going to explore the role that relationships play in this. Now, if you've missed any of the past weeks, be sure to catch them at bridgechurches.ca/on-demand. Now, to kick things off, I'm going to hand it over to the band for a song called God So Loved. It's a beautiful invitation to each of us, no matter where we are or what we're going through, to come to God and experience His love.
God so loved the world.
Well, I don't know about you, but I am so thankful for that reminder today that no matter our failures or struggles, Jesus is there at the foot of the cross with arms open wide, inviting us into a place of love. Now, if you'd like to have a conversation with someone about what a relationship with Jesus looks like, please reach out to us by going to bridgechurches.ca and clicking on the chat bubble in the bottom right. Someone will be in touch with you. Now, just a few things to share with you today. The first is concerning our Kanata campus that we have just relaunched. If you're watching this today and you're interested in joining us for an in-person service, we need you to go to bridgechurches.ca/events and register. Now, because of the restrictions that we need to adhere to, space is limited and it fills up really quickly. And it's open now, so jump onto a device and register. Now, as you might know, we are now one church in two locations. And we are so excited to see what God is doing both in our online and our in-person environments. And as you can imagine, there's so much that goes into making everything happen. And as we grow, there are going to be more and more opportunities for you to serve. Now, one area of need for our online environment is chat hosts. We need people just like you every Sunday morning to jump into chat and connect with those in our online community. This role is straightforward, but it's essential in creating community online. Now, if you're interested in helping us build irresistible bridges in this way, please go to bridgechurches.ca/serve and let us know. Lastly, we want to thank you for your faithfulness each week as you continue to invest financially in the mission and vision of the bridge. We believe that God uses ordinary people for extraordinary purposes, and no matter what you're able to give, He can use it to change lives. One of those lives that has changed as a result of you is a daughter of a good friend of mine. They began attending the Bridge online last Christmas and over time decided to make the Bridge their community. This summer, as restrictions lifted, my friend's daughter began to attend our student ministry's events, and immediately she found community. She said this of her experience: "I love youth group so much. Coming to youth group was one of the best decisions I've ever made. I have been praying for Christian friends, and now I am surrounded by amazing people who love Jesus. It's so fun. Each and every week, I look forward to going and spending time with everybody." Now, the goal of student ministry is to make sure that every young person has someone and some place where they belong and someone who cares about them, no matter the circumstances. And your investment each week allows us to do that. So, as you think of this young woman and the countless other young people just like her, know that your giving makes a difference in their lives. Now, if you'd like to find out more about what is happening in our student ministries, go to bridgechurches.ca/youth. And if you're interested in giving and haven't done so before, just go to bridgechurches.ca/give. Now, I'm going to hand it back to the band now for a song called "To the One." Team?
Hiding. Bring your scars, bring your shame. Every failure, every secret. Bring your fear, the things won't change. Bring your dreams, bring your worries. Highest high.
To the one who came to save, to the one whose love is strong. Well, it's so great to be with you today, wherever you are, and I hope that our time together thus far has been uplifting and encouraging, and I'm really looking forward to this opportunity to share with you today. If this is your first time joining us, a special hello and welcome to you. My name is Scott, and today we're in the third part of this series called Roots. And again, if this is your first time with us, or if you weren't here with us live last week or weren't able to catch last week's service, I would really, really, really encourage you to go to the on-demand section of our webpage and watch that message, because all of these things that we're talking about in this series build on each other. So just head to bridgechurches.ca/on-demand. But just to catch you up quickly, as I reflect on my own personal spiritual journey and what God has used to shape it, and when I reflect on the conversations that I've had with people over the years who are new to faith or been walking with the Lord longer than I've been alive and everyone in between, there are five things that keep popping up over and over and over again in those conversations as it relates to deepening our faith. So the goal or the purpose of this series is to share these five things with you with the hope that you'll be aware of these things so that you can see them at work in your life as God seeks to deepen the roots of your faith so that it will stand tall and strong no matter what does or doesn't happen in your life. Last week we talked about the first one, and what we talked about was applicable teaching, or you could say applicable biblical teaching. That is, somebody teaches the Bible, and at the end of the message, we don't just know more. At the end of the message, we know what to do with what we've learned. That one of the things that deepens the roots of our faith and helps your faith stand tall and strong is when you expose yourself and put yourself in environments where people teach the Word of God, not just in terms of, here's something else to know, or here's something I bet you didn't know, but they teach the Word of God within the context of application. In other words, here's what to do, and here's how to do it, and here's somebody who's going to try to inspire you, not just to knowledge and not to working out the theological intricacies of Scripture, which is all fun and interesting, and I get into that from time to time, but here is someone who's going to try to inspire you to do something. One of the things that deepens the roots of our faith, one of the best things that you can do for you, for your kids, your spouse, your future spouse, who you're dating, one of the best things that you can do for the people that you love is to be involved with them in environments where somebody opens up the Bible and teaches from it in a way that's practical and applicable. That was last week. And again, I would encourage you to go back and watch that message if you missed it. Now today, what I want to do today is I want to talk about the second one. And to get us started, I need you to help me out. Can you do that? Throughout this series, I've asked you to use your imagination a number of times. But today I want you to use your memory. Your memory. Today, I want you to think back and I want you to answer one of two questions, whichever question most applies to you. I want you to think back and I want you to picture someone that you feel like God used in a relationship with you to make your faith grow. Now, I'd rather it not be a family member, but if it has to be or if it is, that's okay, that's fine. But the question is, who do you feel, looking back on your life, who did God bring into your life, and as a result of that relationship, you feel like your faith in God got deeper and stronger? That they came into your life just when you needed them, and you wouldn't be who you are, your faith wouldn't be what it is had they not come into your life when they did. Now, the second question is for you if you would say, you know, Scott, I can't play because I'm not really a person of faith. I don't even know what I believe yet. I got here by accident, or I'm exploring faith. I've got lots of questions. I've got some things. I've got some issues with the church. I have some questions or issues with the Bible. If that's you, that's okay. And I get that you may not like this question or not know how to answer it necessarily. So here's the question that I'd like for you to answer, if you would. I'd like you to answer this question. Who in your life has caused you to have interest in faith or to re-examine faith? Who in your life has caused you to give faith a chance or maybe give God a chance? It may be a person that you've known for years. It may be the person who invited you or told you about the Bridge online. But who do you feel like? You don't even have to say it was God because you're not even sure you believe that there is a God. And that's okay. I totally understand that. But who in your life, who do you have a relationship with that it seems like, well, like because of that relationship, it's like you've taken a new interest in or you've become curious once again about faith. Who is that for you? Now, whichever question relates most to you isn't the issue, but whoever it is, I just want you to get in your mind that person and picture who that was. And I want you to picture who you were when they came into your life. Can you see them? Can you see you when they came into your life? Okay, good. Now, if I were to answer that question for you, one person comes to mind, and he comes to mind really quickly. His name is Dennis. I met Dennis when I was 15 years old and at a time in my life where I had been exposed to faith, but I wasn't really sure what I believed. I started going to youth group because of a girl, and after attending for a little while, I became more comfortable, not with her, but with the whole thing, and I started attending that youth group regularly. There were a couple of leaders there who, and they were all, you know, they were all amazing, and they were all students at what is now Kingswood University. They were all great leaders, they were fun people, and after a few months of being there, we were all introduced to a new leader, Dennis. Dennis was a student at that same university, but Dennis was different and he stood out right away. He was tall, he wasn't overly athletic looking, and he had big ears and big, thick glasses. But what was different more than that about Dennis was the fact that he was clearly older than all the other leaders. He was what the school classified as a mature student. He was in his early 30s and had started school later than most of the other students. He was married, he had three young kids, and due to the accelerated schedule that he was on, not just his age, but his schooling, he needed to get practical hours, and serving in a local church is how you get those at Kingswood. So Dennis came over to me that night, and he introduced himself, and we got to talking about music and sports, and I was surprised to find out that we had a lot in common, because at first glance, I wouldn't have thought so. But Dennis asked me if I wanted to hit up a basketball court later that week to hang out, and for those who know me, that was all I needed. I was in. And so we went to a local court that Saturday, and we were shooting around on one end, while some of my friends that I normally played with were on the other end of the court. Now, I didn't go down there because Dennis was awful. I mean, he was clanking shots off the backboard. I mean, he was lucky to hit the rim. I mean, he barely hit the rim. Very few times did a shot go in. There was no way I was going to get into a game with my buddies and have to explain what I was doing with Dennis or where I found Dennis. Dennis clanked another shot, and after I ran after the ball, when I turned back around, Dennis was on the other end of the court with my friends asking if they wanted to play a game. And I'm looking like, man, you got to be kidding me. So, of course, we go down there, and of course, Dennis was the last one picked as we made teams, and of course, he was on my team. Now, those who know me know how competitive I am, and already I was annoyed with the prospect of losing. So here's Dennis. He was being goofy and goofing around and making jokes, and then right before the game started, he walks over to me, and he leaned over, and with the most serious face and the most serious tone that I ever heard him speak, and he said, "Throw the ball up by the rim." I looked at him and was like, "What?" But the look in his eyes was so serious. I was like, okay. Dennis walked off. I checked the ball. We locked eyes. He took off. I threw up the ball toward the rim, and that joker leaped in the air like a gazelle, caught the ball in the air, and dunked it with two hands. He hung on the rim, you know, for a few seconds just for good measure before he came back to the ground, and instantly, I mean instantly, three things came to my mind. One, dang, we just got hustled. Two, we're winning this game. And three, I just found my new best friend. And that's exactly what happened. From that moment on, Dennis became like a best friend. Dennis took me under his wing. In church world, we use the term, he discipled me. You can call it whatever you want to call it, but essentially, Dennis mentored me. Dennis made my life his business. He took me out at least once a week, and oftentimes it was more than that, and when he did, he talked to me. When he did, he listened to me. He challenged me. He questioned me. He spoke into my life things that I had never heard a man say. And as a 15-year-old and 16-year-old boy, he became a big brother or a father figure to me, neither of which was something that I had ever had. And he made me see and believe things about myself that I never had. He had me into his home almost every Friday night for pizza and board games with his wife, Natalie. Their three little daughters became like my little sisters. I mean, I became a fixture in their home. And he and his family became one in my heart. Dennis believed that there was a calling on my life for ministry, and he pushed me to consider walking through that door, which I eventually did, in large part due to his influence. I can honestly say that I wouldn't be who I am, I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing today, had Dennis not had to serve at that church to complete his degree. And when I look back on that season of my life, I can easily associate my relationship with Dennis with the word providential. That from my perspective, looking back, it's as if God brought Dennis into my life at a critical juncture. It's as if God knew what I needed and then provided who I needed. Now, I had a part to play. I could have said to Dennis, no, I don't have time to hang out with some old Christian guy, right? I could have said, no, Dennis, I don't want to play basketball with you. It's Saturday. I'm going to go hang out with some of my friends. I mean, I could have brushed him off. I could have said, you know what? I don't have time to sit around and listen to your stories and listen to your perspectives. I had a part to play. It's not like God forced Dennis's way into my life. But looking back, because I chose, by the grace of God, because I chose to participate and to lean into that relationship, because of that, looking back, I think of Dennis and Natalie as a providential relationship. And together they shaped and in some ways planted my faith. And I'm forever grateful. They shaped my view of God. They shaped my understanding of Christianity, something I had no perspective on prior to meeting them. They shaped my view of the world, and they helped me understand how the truth of God intersects and integrates into real life, into my life. I consider those relationships to be providential relationships. And here's the thing, and you know this based on who came to your mind. Whenever you hear a story of faith, whenever you hear somebody talk about, you know, here's how I feel like God worked and moved in my life. Whenever you hear stories of faith, whenever you hear stories of faith, you always hear stories of relationships. I mean, I've never heard, and maybe this is your story, and if that is, you're an exception, but I've never heard in isolation, I found God. I've never heard that. I've never heard on my own, I discovered God and grew in my faith in God and became everything that God wanted me to be, and it had absolutely nothing to do with anyone else in my life. I think if you think that's your story, you probably don't even know your own story very well. But generally speaking, when people tell their story, they talk about, and they don't use this term, but they talk about providential relationships. And when they talk about it, it sounds something like this. You know, I was going along and I was doing my own thing, and then I met this girl. Or I was going along kind of doing life my own way, and then I met this guy. Everything was fine, and then these girls invited me to this thing, and they called it a Bible study, and I'm like, what is there to study? But I didn't know anybody else in the neighborhood. I was new, and so I went, and for the first time in my life, it's like, oh, I met this person at this thing that I was volunteering at, and we started talking. And as we were talking, something about his life kind of captured my attention. You know what? We began a friendship. All of us have that person in our mind, and when you look back, you would say something like, you know what, they came into my life seemingly accidentally, but looking back, I just feel like God just kind of meshed our lives together in that season of my life. And isn't it true that your faith is deeper because of them? Or isn't it true that you have questions about faith that you've never asked before because of them? And it's not just because of them, but also because of the circumstances in which they came into your life. And when they came into your life, whenever you hear stories of faith, you always hear stories about relationship. And that's why I believe that one of the five things that God uses on a consistent basis in our lives to deepen the roots of our faith are relationships that, looking back, seem to be providential relationships. For some of us, we'd say we came back to church. Other of us might say that we came for the first time because of a relationship with someone that, again, looking back, it seems like they providentially intersected with our life. And so here's the principle, here's the purpose, here's the point of today's message. It's simply this, that God uses human relationships to deepen the roots of our faith in Him. That's it. That's what it is. That's all it is, that God uses human relationships to deepen the roots of our faith and our confidence in Him. Now, sadly, the opposite is true as well. I mean, this is a principle, and like all principles, it works both ways, right? Because the other question I could ask you to answer today that would maybe be a little more awkward to answer is, what if I were to ask you something like this? What if I asked you this question? Has there been anyone in your life that, looking back, has there been anyone in your life who undermined your faith in God? Are there any relationships in your past that, as you look back, are there relationships that kind of took the legs out from underneath your faith? That as a result of that relationship, isn't it true maybe that you have someone in your life that caused you to believe less? That as a result of that relationship, you found yourself further from God and further from where you wanted to be in life, in relationships, financially, in marriage? Isn't it true that oftentimes, relationships undermine, or at least have the potential to undermine our faith? Isn't it true that if you were really honest, isn't it true that your greatest regrets, if you were to trace them back, you would trace them back to a relationship? A phone call you wish you had never returned? a text message you wish you'd never responded to, an invitation you wish you had said no to, a date you wish you had never gone out on, a business opportunity you wish you'd walked away from. I mean, isn't it true? Isn't it true that our greatest regrets generally, if you would trace them back, you trace them back to relationships? You see, I don't meet many people. I'm sure there's this case, but I haven't found it. And you don't meet many people who say, you know, my greatest regret has to do with my isolation. That I got into all this trouble all by myself and no one else was involved. I mean, that's a little bit hard to do. I'm sure it's possible, but it's hard to do. Because even the habits that you have such a hard time breaking, they were probably introduced to you through a relationship, right? I mean, why? Because relationships are powerful things. And so here's the takeaway. Here's the point. Relationships intersect with our faith. For good or for bad, relationships intersect with our faith. And that's why, and we can count on this for the rest of our lives. That's why God will use and has the potential to use. That's why God is willing to use. That's why God desires to use relationships in our lives in order to deepen our faith. Because the wrong kinds of relationships have the potential to undermine our faith. And the right kind of relationships have the potential to help our faith grow tall and strong. So the challenge is, what do you do with that? I mean, I doubt too many people would argue with me. I mean, you might. But for the most part, we have enough personal history to see that there really aren't any neutral relationships, right? There really aren't any neutral relationships. Everybody you come into contact with in some way either erodes your faith in God or helps it to grow. So if that's the case, what do you do? What do you do? I mean, a providential relationship isn't something you can go out and do or go out and get. You just can't do it. You just can't get it. It just kind of happens. That's true. But here's why I think this is so important and why I think it's worth talking about. I believe that this is a reality we can leverage. And I believe by being aware of the significance of relationship as it relates to our faith, I believe that we can leverage this principle. Now, you may have been raised in a religious tradition and you've never heard anyone talk about this before, and I get that. Maybe in your religious tradition, faith was all about Sunday morning events. Faith was all about someone reading something to you or saying something to you. Faith was all about your prayer life. Faith was all about this personal, private, Sunday kind of thing. So consequently, you've never asked this question. How can I leverage relationships for the sake of deepening the roots of my faith? How can I leverage it? And if you've never asked that question, you may be missing out on one of the primary things that God would like to use going forward in your life to deepen and establish your faith. See, here's what I believe is true, and I'm going to try to make a case for this for the rest of our time together today, but I think there are things that we can do to work with our Heavenly Father to create what you might consider, looking back, to be providential relationships. Because in every relationship that you're in, you have a choice to make, right? You have a choice to make. And it could be that there are relationships that God is setting you up for right now, and if you're not careful, you'll miss them. I say that because I can imagine that most of us could look back on a time in our lives, if you've lived long enough, to where if you kind of accept, you know, the whole idea that God may bring people into our lives for a purpose, I bet many of us could tell stories of, you know, Scott, looking back a year ago or 5 years ago or 10 years ago, there was this person who kind of came crashing into my life in a unique way, or there was this person who moved in next door, or there was this person who was constantly trying to talk to me about God at work. There was this person that kept wanting to have lunch with me. There was this person who kept asking me to go for coffee. There was this couple that kept inviting me and my wife to church, and I just kept putting them off. There was this pastor who kept telling us that circles are better than rows and how we should get connected with other people at the church. But every time he started talking like that or talking about that, I just kind of tuned him out. Well, perhaps that was God's way of trying to get your attention through this principle, get your attention through a relationship. But you had a choice to make and you decided to walk away or you decided to tune it out. But what I want to encourage you to think about today is, let's not do that anymore. That if relationships can be providential, if God uses people to plant and build and create greater and deeper faith, then the question that we need to ask, the question you and I need to ask is, how do we leverage that? Not how do I go into another season of my life and miss that? Now today I want to show you a couple of passages of Scripture. Actually, they're really just two verses. One's in the Old Testament and one is in the New Testament. But the reason that I want to show you these verses today is because they reiterate for us what our experience already tells us that God uses people, that God uses relationship to impact and to deepen our faith, our trust, our confidence in Him. The first one I want to show you is found in the book of Proverbs, and I love Proverbs. I always tell people that Proverbs is like a big book of fortune cookies written by a man named Solomon, who is said to be the wisest man who ever lived. And in his wisdom and in his writings, Solomon wrote this. He said this, "Walk with the wise." Now, in the original language, this is more of an observation rather than a command. But he says, "Walk with the wise and become wise, for a companion of fools suffers harm." A companion of fools. Doesn't that sound like a fortune cookie? Now, if you don't have to be a Christian, you don't have to be a religious person or even that insightful of a person to understand the nature and the relationship reflected in this verse right here. That he who walks with the wise becomes wise. And the companion of fools, well, they suffer harm. And see, this goes back to what I said just a minute ago, that your greatest regret in mind was somehow connected to other people. That your greatest regret stems back to, you could trace it back to, a relationship. That's true for you, my guess is, and it's true for me. And see, here's the wisdom of this verse. What Solomon is saying here is he's saying, people you choose to surround yourself with have the potential to impact your faith. That the people that you choose to spend time with, because of the nature of what wisdom means in the Old Testament, that if you choose to walk with wise people, if you choose to do life with wise people, surround yourself with the right kinds of people, that God uses those relationships to create something good in you. And in this case, and in the Old Testament context, that's wisdom. But what Solomon, in his wisdom, is saying is, there is a spiritual component to relationships. And maybe for you, this is nothing new. Or maybe for you, this is like a brand new category. This is completely new to you. To think that there is a spiritual component to relationships. That there has the potential to be an incredible spiritual component to relationships because God uses people to deepen the roots of our faith. Now, the second verse is from the New Testament, and it's written by a man named Paul, who is writing to a group of believers in a place called Corinth. And his letters, these letters that he wrote to them, are known to us as the book of 1 and 2 Corinthians in our Bible. And in the first of these letters, Paul writes this, and this is powerful. He says, "Do not be misled. Bad company corrupts good character." And he's not talking about the band Bad Company, right? He's not like, dun-dun-dun-dun, 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 I feel like, okay, this isn't about cheesy 70s rock music, okay? The point Paul was making is simply this. And in this verse, this is the verse, if you have kids and you think, oh, I need to hang that on my kid's wall, you know, bad company corrupts good character. This isn't just for your kids, this is for you. What is he saying here? What is he saying to you? What is he saying to me? He's saying that human relationships can have a negative spiritual impact. Human relationships can have a negative spiritual impact. Now, you may not be a follower of Jesus or a religious person, but you know that relationships can have a negative impact. And see, that's why God, who loves you, that's why God, who has invited you to call Him Heavenly Father, God, who cares about your character and cares about your morality and cares about the consequences of your decisions, that's why He says, you know what? This is so much more than simple common sense, okay? There is a spiritual component to this. That the wrong kind of influences impact you in a way that creates the wrong kind of outcomes and the wrong kinds of behaviors. And what does or doesn't happen in that one area of your life has the potential to uproot your entire faith. Because again, there is a spiritual nature to relationships. And just as he or she who walks with the wise has the potential to grow wise, so in the same way, the companion of fools suffers harm. And in the same way, bad company corrupts good character. So if this is a principle that works for us or against us, if this is a principle that God wants to use or to leverage, if God wants to leverage a relationship in order to deepen the roots of your trust in Him, what do you do? What do we do? What is our part in this? See, the answer to this question is why we are so focused on and are driven to create relational environments here at The Bridge. This is why we, even though we can't have people stick around in the building these days, this is why we spend a lot of time, a lot of money, and energy trying to create a lobby experience outside. And it's why we think it's worth your time to stick around for 15 minutes or more if you can be with us in person or when you can be with us in person. We value relationships here greatly because of how critical they are to our faith. That's why you hear us constantly talk about circles being better than rows, and it's why we want you to connect in groups. We don't say circles are better than rows because we just think it's a catchy slogan. We say it because we believe it, and that's why we're constantly trying to move people out of homes and out of rows and into circles, into connection, into community. It's not because we think we can create a providential relationship. We do it because we believe we can create the potential for a providential relationship. And if you'll allow us to, we believe that we have the ability to create the potential for one of those connections, one of those relationships to where you look back a year from now or 6 months from now and you go, wow, so glad I met him. I met her. We had this in common. And when I heard their story, all of a sudden I'm thinking about life in completely different terms. To get you to the place where you'd say, they came into my life just when I needed them. It can't be a coincidence. It's like God knew what I needed and then provided who I needed. And that conclusion deepens the roots of your faith. See, the way we leverage this principle is to be intentional about putting ourselves in environments where God may create a providential relationship, a providential meeting, a mind-boggling, wow, I can't believe I've gone this long without knowing that person. To where you would say, I can't imagine having lived life without meeting you and our lives intersecting. To get you to the place where you'd look at someone and say, I'm so thankful God brought you into my life. God is willing and able to do that, but we have a part to play because you always have a choice in relationships. And the part that you can play and the part that I can play is being intentional about putting ourselves in a position where those relationships might happen. And that's why if you have kids, that's why you need to get them into Bridge Kids, where they are in a circle where another adult is speaking into their lives. See, I promise you the day will come when you'll wish that they'd been in that environment. But I also promise you this, if you wait until you feel the need for it, it's going to be too late. What you need, the best thing that you can do for kids is to get them in a group of relationships that as time goes by, God may providentially connect them to a group leader who echoes what and how you see them. And the role that person plays in their life could be talked about for the rest of their life. But you can't wait until grade 11 for that to happen. Now is the time to do that. And it's not about church programming. It's about purposely putting them in environments for potential relationships that God may use in an extraordinary way to deepen the roots of their faith. That's why if you're a student, that's why you need to go to the Anchor or to the Well. These are our student ministry environments for middle school and high school students. And I know you might say, well, I went once or I tried that once and it wasn't really for me. But listen, this is why if you're a student, this is why you need to stay involved in the student ministry. Because when you do you know what you're saying when you do? You're saying, God, I can't create a relationship. I can't make something happen, but God, I'm going to do my part. And I just trust that you'll deepen my faith by bringing some relationships into my life that I didn't expect, but relationships that I'll never forget. And that's why, whether you're single or if you're married, that's why we want to help you connect with other adults in a circle. Each series we do, like Roots, we put together content and questions to help you converse around these ideas that we talk about like this. Please don't just sit here and listen to me preach week after week, okay? I'm glad you're here, but don't let it stay there. Please consider helping us move this from being a monologue to the beginning of a dialogue. Because it's when you get together with other people that you do your part in creating the opportunity for God to bring a pivotal relationship into your life. And when you do your part, and then that person shows up in your life, your faith will grow deeper. See, one of the things we need now more than ever, what we need now is for people to help facilitate these type of environments. You don't have to be a biblical scholar to do that. What you need is a willing heart and a willingness to facilitate a conversation. We've done our part by putting together all the material that you're going to need. We've done all the heavy lifting. We just need you to consider doing your part. So would you? Would you consider facilitating a conversation with a few other people or a few other couples and do your part to create the potential for providential relationships to come into your life? If this is something at all that's stirring in you right now that says, you know what, I could do that or I should try that. That's interesting. Don't brush it off. I want to challenge you to contact Jeremy, who manages our circles, and talk to him about this opportunity. To do that, to connect with Jeremy, you just need to head over to bridgechurches.ca/circles. And when you get on that webpage, there's just a little button that you can click. And when you do that, Jeremy will be in touch with you and talk to you about what you could do to open the door for that kind of relationship to come into your life. And here's the thing. you will never know what could happen as a result of your yes. Dennis and Natalie said yes, and I'm here talking to you about this today because of it. Think about this. What could happen in your life as a result of your yes? I'll say it again. God uses human relationships to deepen the roots of our faith in Him. God uses human relationships to deepen our faith and our trust in Him. It's just that simple. But the point is this. This is a principle that works all the time, and we either work with it and benefit from it, or we ignore it and we miss out. When I first started out in ministry, I started in student ministry, and even though I'm not in student ministry anymore, it's still a passion for me, and it's something that I believe is vital to the life of the church and critical in the life of students. And during that season of my ministry, one of the things that I would say, and this is now something that I see at play in the life of my own teenager, one of the things that I would say to students all the time, I'd say it all the time, what I would say to them is this: your friends determine the direction and quality of your life. Your friends determine the direction and quality of your life. I would say that to them all the time. Your friends determine the direction and quality of your life. And if you're a parent, you're going, wow, that's good. I'm going to steal that. I'm going to use that. Pause. Because it's true of you. And it's true of me. That our friends determine the direction and quality and the depth of our faith in God. Because God uses relationships to impact and grow our faith in Him. The question is, how do you need to leverage this in your life? Do you need to leverage it by being intentional about some new relationships and giving God an opportunity? Do you need to leverage this by being more available as a person who's willing to intersect with a person who maybe needs to hear what you have to say and maybe needs to know what you've known for a long time or hear about the experience you've been through, who maybe needs to hear your perspective about what's going on in his or her life? God wants to deepen the roots of our faith because that's what allows it to stand tall and strong, and it's what gives us confidence and trust in Him no matter what happens to us, in us, or around us. And that's the kind of faith and confidence that leads to intimacy. So when you hear us talk about a growing relationship with Christ, this is right at the heart of all that. And one of the ways that God deepens His relationship with us is through our relationship with other people. But we have to choose to cooperate. We've got to choose to cooperate. And for some of us, that means cooperating by being more intentional about moving into those types of relationships. For others of us, it's about being more available to be used by God in the life of another person who needs to have a relationship that they'll look back on 6 months or a year from now and say, wow, God brought him, meaning you, or God brought her, you, or God brought them, you and your husband, or you and your wife. God brought them into my life at such a critical time. Speaking of you, they would say, I'm so glad they decided to make my business their business. And I'm so glad that they invited me for the fifth time. And I'm so glad that they didn't give up. And I'm so glad that they created an opportunity and facilitated a conversation, because looking back, the intersection of my life with their lives is what started me on this journey of faith. And I wouldn't be who I am. I wouldn't be where I am. I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing. I wouldn't have the faith I have today were it not for them then. God uses relationships to grow our faith, and I believe that God wants to use your relationships to grow yours. Don't miss out on that opportunity. Be willing to open the door for a providential relationship to come into your life.
Well, that is it for us this week. Just one final thing. If you didn't know, I'm the Jeremy that Scott was talking about in the message today. Nice to meet you. Now, we are so excited to experience what God is going to do at the Bridge as we reimagine how we connect here as a community. Now, if you're interested in seeing how you can play a role in facilitating a circle in your community, simply go to bridgechurches.ca/circles. Don't worry, there's no commitment yet. It's merely a first step in finding out more about how we want you to be a part of connecting in circles. Now that's really it for us this week. Much love. God bless.